Steve Trevelise and Fox Sports 1's Mike Garafolo analyzing the upcoming Giants-Eagles game. How you been, my friend, little cuz?
I'm great, my man. How are you making out?
Now you're growing up, cuz. Now you're a big star. Look at you. Fox Sports 1. You break the news, as always, before everyone else finds out about it. It's like tell Mikey, then tell everybody else.
I try my best, my man. I try my best.
So, all right, now... It's got to be different for you because now you're more national. You know, like last year you were covering the Jets, you trade and so-and-so. So now you cover national sports, so you can objectively look, as you always did, at the Giants-Eagles game without any kind of bias. I mean, because you've been on both sides of the fence. You've been an Eagle fan covering the Giants, and now what do you think of this game?
I think it's a game between two imperfect teams is the word that I would use to describe them. But look, you know, both are playing better than they were. I mean, if this game happened week two, it would be turn your eyes and look away. The Eagles do have some stuff that they can work with off of that Saints game, but that Saints team is terrible. They're really, 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 really bad. And so you look at it, and you look at the final score, and you say, okay, they got their act together, and you know, Sam Bradford talking about that meeting in the showers, and we can finally do it and bring it together, and this is what people have been waiting for. You're still not there. And that Giants team, you know, they played a Niners team who you could say the same things about, but they're not very good. But that was a tough game the other night. That defense is still pretty good, and Eli Manning is playing some good football here. So, yeah, I kind of lean a little Giants here, but it is a home game on a Monday night in Philly, so it's going to be interesting, and it'll be something that it'll be a game that's going to register across the league. People will be interested and will tune in for this one.
Well, yeah, because it's a precursor of what could come, and the Giants went down there last year and got spanked in Philadelphia, humiliated. They lost Victor Cruz. Now it looks like they've lost all their wide receivers. Beckham may not play. What is it with the hamstrings on the Giants that every week three or four guys go out with a hamstring?
Well, I mean, it's hamstrings across. When you've got a guy who moves like Odell Beckham moves, and look, and LeSean McCoy, I mean, he's dealing with a hamstring thing, and the calf thing is a different deal for Victor Cruz. I mean, the calves are worse than hamstrings. And when you get to this part of the season, you say, all right, do I want to come back before I know for sure I'm 100% recovered, but I may suffer another strain because of it? Or do I want to get out there and play because, as Beckham said, you know, I love the game, and these are the kind of situations that you want to be in. I mean, I would think with the Giants in their situation and, you know, not... I think the key in the NFC East is not falling too far behind. I mean, nobody's good enough to pull away. So you just want to make sure that you don't fall too far behind. So if I'm the Giants and I don't have Reuben Randall and I don't have Victor Cruz, I think I throw Odell Beckham out there and give it a shot. And, you know, just tell him to hope to be smart about it. I mean, the fact that he went in the game, mm-hmm. the day he went back in, tells me that it's not extremely significant, but it's something that if you don't treat it right and you don't listen to it, you know, could lead to a further strain.
It opened up the lane for Larry Donnell to make that David Tyree-like catch. How about Daniel Fells, the tight end? Where'd that come from? Mercer, and he got it from a cortisone shot.
Well, that's still being figured out. Fells was experiencing pain before the cortisone shot. I mean, obviously that was the reason for the cortisone shot. It's unclear if that pain was because of an infection that was already in there. And then if you do that and you take a cortisone shot, that only blows the thing up. That makes it infinitely worse. So that may have been what led to the great breakout was he already had the infection. They didn't realize it, gave him the cortisone shot, boom, and now they're trying to, you know, as it was phrased the other day, save the foot. I mean, that gives the impression that the guy's about to lose his foot. He really wasn't there.
Right.
It never was like, oh, man, we're going to, you know, Daniel, you're in a bad spot here. You may be without a foot soon. It never really got to that point, but it was always on the table. It was always, it always is when you've got MRSA. It's a serious, serious infection, especially when it's left unchecked for a while, and that seems to have been the case here on this one. I mean, he's a good player. Probably would have rolled him in a little bit more as the season's gone along, but it's not a devastating loss for them. It's a devastating loss for him personally. I wouldn't be surprised if he does not play another game.
Talking with Fox Sports 1's Mike Garafolo. When you look at these two teams, the Giants and the Eagles, the Giants seem to look much more comfortable in their offense in the 1 year that has gone by that they've been running it under Ben McAdoo. Chip Kelly, granted, made a lot of personnel changes, but they don't look as comfortable in Kelly's offense, do you think?
Yeah, that's fair. And it's not that not necessarily from an X's and O's standpoint, a scheme standpoint. It's more a tempo thing. I mean, they've got to get rolling. They've got to get up on the ball. That's what Chip does. It's not a complicated system. It's just about conditioning and the ability to process information faster than the guys on the other side of the ball, and that's what gives you the edge in this league. It's tempo beats talent is what you always hear from coaches when it's executed well, and they're just not doing that right now. So I know they're working on that, and obviously Chip sees that and wants Bradford to work quicker. So I'm looking for a little bit more of that from this team. And you'll know it when you see it. Right up on the ball, boom, snap it, go. Nobody does it in this league better than Tom Brady. But if you see some semblance of that, you'll know that Bradford and his guys are getting more comfortable. I mean, and the Giants, it still, at times, looks a little goofy for me to see Eli Manning running an offense that requires such good footwork out of a quarterback. He doesn't have great footwork. Aaron Rodgers has great footwork, and that's the system that they run. So it's a little bit of a square peg in a round hole for me still, but you look at where he is right now versus where he was the first couple of weeks of last season. It's night and day, and certainly having Beckham, a guy that can stop on a dime and cut back across the field and then strain his hamstring while dancing in the end zone, that certainly helps.
You think Chip Kelly's got the players to fit his offense? You think these are the better players than what he had?
Yeah, I just don't think that they're blocking well. Look, of all the moves that they made this offseason, the one that I still question the most is releasing Evan Mathis because you wanted to make a statement. And his story afterward that, they told us he wasn't coming back unless he got a new deal. Well, so what? I mean, that's the point of a holdout and a threat and trying to create leverage where there is none. So you just sit there and you wait and you say, no, you're playing under the deal or you're not playing at all. And now they're just not able to block up the middle and they lost Gardner. And that's their biggest issue. That's why DeMarco Murray is running sideways instead of up the field. That's why Chip Kelly wanted DeMarco Murray. Because unlike LeSean McCoy, he's a guy who can hit the hole, and if there's 4 yards to be had, he's going to get four. Whereas McCoy, maybe he could have gotten 14 because he's shifty, but a lot of times he'd get -4, and that's what drove Kelly crazy. But you can't do that. You can't get right up the field. You can't go north and south if your guys up the middle are not blocking. So until that changes, you can't really prove my point that, yes, he does have the right guys for the system, but they need to block it up there.
He'd rather go forward and not sideways, but he's forced to go sideways because he's not getting the upfront blocking. All right, so it's incumbent on a good general manager. I said this when the Giants played the Redskins, and they just didn't have a pass rush. I was talking to a guy I was watching a game with saying, it's incumbent on a good general manager. Somewhere out there is a pass rusher that can be had cheap, that can come in here and turn this thing around or make a difference or at least provide a pass rush, and it's up to the general manager to find it. And if you remember, go back to 13. When six games in, Jerry Reese finds John Beeson, and the Giants finish the year 7-3. Mm-hmm. And I said that 2 days later, Jared Allen gets shaken loose from the Bears and goes to the Panthers. So
yeah.
Isn't it incumbent? Like, Kelly, the general manager, is too busy being Kelly the coach. But isn't there a lineman out there somewhere that can be sprung?
I thought it was Dwight Freeney. That guy was just sitting out there. And
He just signed today.
He did. He signed yesterday. And that's why, when I saw it happen, I said, well, where were the Giants on this one? That team needs a pass rush. They badly missed Pierre Paul, and people saying, Pierre Paul had tailed off. He's still an incredible talent. But not now. I mean, who knows what you're going to get with this guy. But, before the injury, still an incredible talent and a guy that needs to be accounted for. They just don't have that. Now the problem with Jared Allen is he doesn't fit the Eagles scheme. He's the kind of guy that's got to line up at defensive end, you point him in the backfield, and you say, you go there. And you attack, and if it's a run, you try and blow it up. If it's a quarterback, you just go get the quarterback. And that's what it was when he first signed in Chicago, and it wasn't the case once John Fox came in, and that was a bad fit. So, you know, give the Panthers credit. They needed that. They saw what was happening in Chicago. They jumped on it. They didn't give up a whole lot to get him. So I thought that was an incredible move by them because that guy still got plenty to give. But when you look at Freeney, who's frankly a guy that's been versatile in his career, can play a little bit. He's played linebacker. He's played defensive end, played different kinds of systems. I was shocked that he actually sat out there as long as he did because he signed for the veteran minimum. And at this point in the season, nothing's guaranteed.
We have nothing to lose. What's the problem with DeMontre Moore and the Giants? Every time he gets in, he gets the quarterback, and he never gets in.
Well, not every time. I mean, he does.
Most every time, occasionally.
No, he's got to add a little bit more to the arsenal. They don't have. See, Michael Strahan comes in the early '90s, and he's got a lot of skill and ability on his own. And all the way through, what was it, 2011, when OC Umanyora finally left, they had a guy who could always teach the other guys how to rush the passer. And now they don't have that. And Pierre Paul's not a coaching type guy. So the last couple of years, they didn't really have that. I know they still have Mathias Kiwanuka, who, by the way, dropped off the face of the earth.
He's
apparently done with football. But they didn't have a guy who could teach these other guys by example. So, you know, they've got these guys they keep drafting in the third round or second round, or more of the third round. Odigizua, the other guy who's a third round pick that they think could be a pass rusher. Well, you need somebody to show these guys the ropes and show them by example and show them stuff on film. And they don't have that right now. So you need that kind of coach on the field. And that's why I think there's a big part of why these guys aren't developing right now.
Now, how do you feel about the Eagle defense, especially the secondary? They remade it. They spent a lot of money on Byron Maxwell. Is it how much of an upgrade, if at all, do you think it is?
Not much. On Maxwell, not much. And I am always, always leery of these guys who, and he was a starter from time to time, but really a full-time one-year starter. One year in Seattle, which is Richard Sherman is outstanding at what he does, and some of the other guys that play there are outstanding at what they do. But it's really a system where you can get a guy that fits the system and develop, and then you go and that guy becomes a free agent. You lock him up with monster numbers and ask him to be a one-on-one guy, and he's just not that guy. And I think that's what's happening here a little bit. And he'll play well in stretches, I think. And then there's going to be times where he's just going to be exposed. And I really wasn't feeling that. I thought for sure that he was going to go to Atlanta once Dan Quinn went to Atlanta. When that first happened, I said, those guys going here, especially since they were willing to spend. They would have spent some money on him. They just weren't going to spend that much money on him. And if he had gone there, he would have been incredibly successful because it's a similar system. But I'm just, you know, sorry to everybody down there, but I'm still a little bit like, ooh, how's this one going to play out? Because that's a position where you're on an island, and if you're on an island, you're not playing well in that city. Steve, you know how it goes.
No, yeah, and he's a zone guy, and they're asking him to play man, and now he's playing with Walter Thurman, who also played in Seattle. But
who's been playing well? Been playing well?
Yeah, as a safety. And look at the difference Kerry Williams makes in Seattle now. Having left here, you know, the GOAT.
Yeah, and he still struggled at times a little bit, but I know he played well in that Monday night game, so everybody down there was saying, look, you've got to be kidding me. But that's what I'm saying about that offense, is you can get a guy who has good size, and if you teach him proper technique, can play well in that system. So you take a guy out of the system, you got to be careful about saying, oh, this guy's a number one cornerback. Well, he may not be.
You got two teams with a lot of changes meeting again on a Monday night in Philadelphia. How do you see this shaking out?
Right now, I am leaning Giants.
That's why I put you on.
What's that?
That's why I put you on.
Yeah, well,
I'm kidding.
You know, you're the one with the pom poms. I'm just the objective observer here, Stevie. I don't know. I think that they're playing. The quarterback play is is a lot better right now, and that's what has me leaning that way. As a matter of fact, I just sent in my picks this week for FoxSports.com, and I did pick the Giants, so that's the way I'm leaning right now, buddy.
All right, that's Mike Garafolo, Fox Sports 1. Thanks for coming on, my friend. We got to do this again.
You got it, pal.